This is Joe Basso from Music Radar, the place for music makers, and I'm speaking with guitarist John Frusciante. John, how you doing?
Good, how are you?
I'm very good. So you have a new solo album coming out in January called The Empyrean, which is quite an experience. I've been listening to it all week. Now, The Empyrean, if I understand it right, means the place of the highest heaven. Is that correct?
I understand it to mean the highest point in heaven.
Okay. Are you particularly religious? Why did you come up with this term for this record?
My religious point of view is something that I can't really talk about. It goes against my belief system to publicly talk about my own spiritual beliefs. In the case of the record, I think I was more using the highest point in heaven as a symbol for the things in life that we're all reaching for, and those things that are sort of out of our grasp, but yet there's some spark inside us that compels us to want to reach for them and to want to bring ourselves to greater heights, whether it's on an instrument or whether it's whatever it is. As human beings, we just have this need to reach and to reach new heights, and often they're totally out of our grasp, but that doesn't make it any less reasonable to reach for it. There's always a quote the writer William Burroughs used to always quote, which was that there's no goal more worth fighting to attain than, I'm paraphrasing, but it's that there's no goal more worthy of fighting to attain than immortality, you know? And and it's just, while I don't think that it's good to always be sort of believing that the grass is greener on the other side, I really believe in pushing yourself to reach heights that may seem far off, but to just push yourself to get there. And in my case, that's all with music, you know. I've just always tried to reach new heights, and it's also one of the themes of the record, that sometimes in your journey, giving up sometimes can be giving up for a period of time, or can actually be a way of regenerating enough energy to keep pushing yourself higher, you know.
Uh-huh.
And musically, and in the theme of the lyrics, the music on my record repeatedly keeps sort of going from a murky kind of low to a peak, and then down from the peak, and then to another low, and then keeps reaching up again and going higher and higher, and then going down again. And it's, for me, that's like a form of breathing, you know. There's been times in my life where I just painted and stopped even playing music, and you know, and there's been times in my life where I stopped thinking so creatively on my instrument and started thinking purely technically. And I think that all those things had a value, even though it's not something I'd want to, you know, there's not things you desire to do, but I think in the process of trying to go up and up and up, I don't think just solidly doing nothing but going up and up and constantly reaching and pushing yourself, I think eventually that produces a kind of strain where you won't be able to go up any higher, where you can actually, in the long run, gain more momentum if you listen to your clock inside, and you may have to occasionally give up, or in a symbolic sense, you might have to die in order to be reborn.
What I can definitely hear on this record is you're constantly changing your style, constantly evolving, actually disregarding one style after you've done it, both as an instrumentalist and as a vocalist. How do you go about that process?
Well, I don't think it is disregarding, obviously, because I really love the whole record from beginning to end, but it's more just switching it up and changing and trying to approach each song differently, and trying to sort of, like in singing, like try to sort of find a different character for each song.
Right.
I think it really helped me to, nobody was around when I recorded my vocals, so being by myself, I found myself, it was much easier to sort of have fun with it and do a lot of takes until I really was having more and more fun each time, as opposed to when you do it with an engineer, a lot of the time you can't deal with the humiliation of having to do more than a couple of takes or whatever, and it gets frustrating if you have to do any more after that, but when you're by yourself, sometimes you do like 15 takes and the 15th one is like, well, yeah, you know. So I found myself having more and more fun with it every time that I did it, and messing around more every time and stuff. As far as soloing, you know, I usually try to have some sort of a concept in my head of an approach or a sound, or, you know, I think music should be something alive and free, and I don't think that people should just sort of rest on their laurels or or at least I don't like for myself to rest on my laurels or to repeat myself.
Did you record the record at home?
Uh-huh.
It's a dichotomy. It has a very intimate feel, of course, but there's this huge live drum sound that one would get from like a big-time studio album.
Well, it's big-time studio, you know? I mean, it's not... You know, I think it's a myth that you need like a 15-foot ceiling to get a good drum sound. Our drum room is pretty small and oddly shaped, and it's got a really live sound. And we got some amazing drum sounds just in the dining room. I don't think studios are all that. I think it was a really poor misconception that I had for a long time that for something to be a real record, you had to do it in a recording studio. Because anybody at home, just by collecting gear piece by piece, you can make things as good sounding as what they do in a studio. And especially if you're doing all the engineering yourself as a musician, the more you play a part in the mixing, the miking, the twiddling of the knobs and stuff, it's your opportunity to put more and more of your own expression in the music. You know, in other words, if you play a guitar solo, if you're also pushing the faders and EQing it and putting different kinds of reverbs on it at different points, it can be an extension of the same feeling that you played it with. Whereas when somebody else is doing it in these reputable big studios with highly paid engineers, they don't know what you were trying to express. They're not on the inside of the music. They're on the outside of it. And
right.
So, to me, the final thing ends up being thinner in cases like that. Yeah, I think you can get a good sound anywhere for drums, you know, like Motown, where they recorded all that shit.
Oh, yeah, sure.
Tiny little room, you know, it just doesn't matter.
Well, I was particularly impressed by what you do with your voice on so many of the tracks. It reminded me of John Lennon, who was constantly changing the sound of his voice.
Yeah, with anything, like, I need to hear, with music, the music that I like, the way it sounds is where there's constant sonic variation going on, where all the sounds are, where there's movement going on. I think even just in the nature of playing a series of notes on a guitar or a series of chords, it's change that affects us. It's that sense of regularity and at the same time of change and variation that's that magical quality in music that just makes it constantly mean new things to us. And as a song goes on, where the emotional response is constantly going in unexpected places. And so I feel like the sound, with all the, you know, technology that's come about in the last, you know, 100 years of being able to record stuff, that's the thing I like to take advantage of, is to be able to go from one atmosphere to another atmosphere, and to go from one type of vocal sound to another, and to make it seem far away, to make it seem close, to make it seem small, to make it seem big, and to create surreal effects with, you know, flipping the tape backwards and doing weird things with reverbs and delays and stuff. I like to hear music changing all the time, you know. So it's like when I hear records that are just mixed in a straight-ahead way where everything is just balanced with each other and nothing's too soft and nothing's too loud, it's just boring to me. It's not what I want to hear. And when we were mixing this record, my main thing was just to have something that I could blast on the stereo system late at night and, you know, trip out to, you know, just have something where you're just like, whoa, how did that happen? How is that possible? You know, just
yeah,
like...
Yeah.
I don't at all record to, like, impress people or to try to do something good or something. It's more just like I want to make something that I like, that I would want to hear, you know. And in rock music, my favorite mixed records are always these ones that, like, you know, that where the artist had some say, whether, you know, someone like John Lennon who was real adamant about having different vocal sounds in the Beatles or whatever, or Jimi Hendrix, you know, on Electric Ladyland, or George Clinton on the first few Funkadelic records. I like it when they just take their same musical sense that makes them sing or play in the way that they do, and they apply it to the mixing console, you know. So that was totally my approach for this, was just to trip it out as much as possible.